Good evening. Hi, this is Dr. Satyadeep. Today I'll be teaching basic growth concepts. Let us discuss this topic. We are planning about growth and development today. We'll be studying about this. So, what is growth? I think you're all aware of it already that it's all just increase in size, and development is all the unidirectional changes which occurs from a single cell organism till its culmination and death. But why study growth? We should study growth because, even though we are predominantly treating adults, why we should study is that we do a lot of preventive and interceptive procedures, as well as just to understand what is normalcy and what is its variation and its clinical implications that we need to study growth. We'll understand as and when this chapter progresses. So, what are the concepts that we are planning to see? That is pattern, variability, and timing, and of course, a lot of subheadings will be seen today. So, what is pattern? Pattern represents proportionality, and it is just not proportionality at a single point of time, say when the patient comes to our chair, but also its variation over a period of time. So, the commonest example of pattern is cephalocortical growth gradient, as well as Kamen's growth curve. Both comes under this. This has been asked quite a number of times. What is cephalocortical gradient? I think you're aware of it. Cephalo is head and caudal is tail. So there is an increase in growth axis starting from head towards the tail. So structures towards the head, they tend to grow early, but structures towards the tail, they tend to grow late, but they'll be bigger in size. So you can see that face, even though it will be occupying almost half of the size initially during intrauterine life, later on we can see that the legs, it becomes almost double the size. You know, even though it's initially it is half, almost face occupies only 12%, whereas leg forms more than half of the body size. You can see this over here. This has been asked a couple of times. Then same is also true in case of maxilla and mandible. We can see that structure closer to the cranium is of course maxilla. So maxillary growth is slightly earlier. It finishes, especially in the sagittal direction. Mandible, it tends to grow after the maxillary growth and it ceases slightly later. So generally, whenever we are planning to do any maxillary intervention, such as with a headgear, generally we should not just take growth spurt, we should start slightly pubertal spurt, we should start slightly early. That is a clinical implication of it. And with respect to mandibular growth, we start around the puberty, just after the onset. So this can be seen over here. And coming to differential growth. In differential growth, this is also given by Scammon's growth curve. Here, there are four major tissues. Apart from lymphoid, neural, and genital, list all the tissues come under the general category. So, general tissues, it takes a S-shaped curve. And in genital, from birth till around just before onset of puberty, there is not much of a variation. Then there'll be a sudden increase. In neural growth, there'll be a completion before 6 years. And in lymphoid, by around 10 years, it reaches double the adult size, and then it regresses to adult size by the time end of puberty. What is the implication of lymphoid is that around 10 years, when it is double the size, kids, there'll be a higher tendency to have enlarged adenoids and tonsils. So that is the clinical implication. Generally, it will come down automatically. So the same thing is being described over here, as you can see an S-shaped curve. One more thing which I would like to add is maxilla, generally the curvature, the sigmoid curve of general is slightly above the general curve, and mandible, it is slightly below the general curve. That also follows a sigmoid pattern, S-shaped curve. But maxilla is slightly above the general curve, and mandible is slightly below the general curve. If you are asking whether maxilla follows the same curvature as the general, no. Mandible, whether it follows the same as general, no. There is a very slight variation. Mandible is below, maxilla is above. So one more aspect of growth is predictability.
Everybody wants to know what happens after NEET 2022. Everybody is curious. So in the same manner, even over here, we are also curious what happens at a later point of time during growth. Predictability of growth pattern is a specific type of proportionality that exists at a particular point of time. So what is it now plus what is its future variation has to be predicted. So why are we interested? Just to see the future size of a part, say prediction of length of mandible, for example, or relationship between parts. We are interested in that, say whether it's a class 1 jaw relation, class 2 jaw relation, or a class 3. So what will be the relationship at future? Presently, it is like this. What will be in the relationship in the future? And timing of growth events, because all events don't occur together. So we are more interested what time there'll be a growth spurt. Then coming to vectors of growth also, we are interested while we are predicting. So what will be the direction of growth of mandible, whether it will be horizontal, whether it is average or vertical, we are interested in that. Coming to velocity of growth, we see that growth doesn't occur at equal increments every year. Sometime there might be a sudden increase, which is nothing but a growth spurt. So we are also interested when that will occur. And of course, after understanding everything, we want to know whether the applied orthodontic therapy, whether it will work or not. The way to assess this is using Ricketts method. We'll also understand what are the other ways of predicting growth. These are some of the methods of growth prediction. I think it was asked in Andhra Pradesh entrance sometime back. This was given by Hirschfield and Moyers. This is theoretical, regression, experimental, and time series. Theoretical as such, there is no particular model which has come up. It's more like a theoretical concept even now. No particular analysis has come up right now. In coming to regressional methods of growth, we calculate depending upon some sort of a mathematical equation known as a regression equation. So there'll be one variable, which is a dependent variable, and then there will be one or more independent variables. I'll just give you an example. Say over here, say we know some SN length, that is anterior cranial base length at 10 years, and upper face height is also known at 10 years. Using some regression equations, that is based upon a large data, how there'll be a variation. At a later point of time, we can actually, in case if SN becomes 14 at a later point of time, what will be the facial height? There's some equations are there, mathematical equations, in order to predict the future size. Coming to experimental method, in experimental method, a single investigator will sit and do his research, and based upon his observations, he will try to put based on some kind of a analysis. So one of the way of doing this is Ricketts forecast. This is an example of an experimental method of prediction. And the last method is time series. First we saw theoretical, then we saw regression equations, then we saw experimental, then now we are seeing time series. Okay. In time series, this is one more mathematical model. It comprises of four parts. One is trend, that is how long term, how there'll be a what is the trend, what will be the change, and whether there is some oscillation, some minor changes are there, or it is an episodic or cyclic change, what is occurring, and or is it a random or unpredictable kind of a change. This is one more mathematical model, which is time series model of predicting growth. So there is one more way growth prediction can be classified. This was given by Bjork. This has also been asked once, and it can be either in the form of longitudinal or metric or structural. I'll explain everything. What is longitudinal? Longitudinal meaning, say we have a patient comes to our clinic, we take a lateral surf. Again, we see him after another 1 year or 2 years. Again, we take lateral surf. And then we superimpose these and see what is the variation. Say now, say mandible has grown by around 2 millimeters. So probably in another 2 years, it might grow again by another 2 more millimeters. So that is one way of predicting. This can be done over a short period of time. So based on this, Bjork, based on longitudinal method, he gave something known as growth trends. So there are three types of growth trends. Even this has been asked. So type A, type B, and type C of growth trend. In type A, both maxilla and mandible, it grows in unison. In the same rate it grows. So it's an average grower. It will be an average grower. Growth pattern is average. In type B, what happens is maxilla grows slightly more rapid than mandible, because maxilla is growing slightly, and that too in a downward and forward direction more rapidly. For this particular reason, it is more like a vertical growth pattern will be seen. In a type C kind of a growth trend, where lower face develops at a faster rate than middle face, that is, mandible develops at a faster rate than the maxillary region or midfacial region. So because of this, it will be more like a horizontal kind of a growth trend which is seen, that is type C. Coming to metric approach, we saw in the previous longitudinal that there were two serial cephalograms which are taken at two different time frames. In metric approach, we depend upon a single X-ray film, and based upon that, we try to predict the future growth. This is based on some site of a previous existing data. Say somebody has done a research, and based upon that research data, we just pick it up and then use this X-ray in order to predict. So this is by example of this is a Ricketts VTO. VTO is nothing but visual treatment objective, Ricketts VTO. Don't get confused with the class 2 VTO, which we generally wherein we add on surrounding like this and then try to see. That's a different VTO. This is cephalometric visual treatment objective. Visual treatment objective can be cephalometric, it can be clinical based. So there are different VTOs. So the other method of assessing is by structural method. See, Bjork, based upon his cephalometry using tantalum implants, serial superimpositions, he saw that mandible grows in a certain way. He enlisted them and he gave some seven structural signs. These are known as seven structural signs of a good growing mandible. What is a good growing mandible? Which has got a more like an average to a horizontal growth pattern. So this is a good growing mandible rather than a vertical growth pattern where the mandible goes behind, and even the annual increments of growth is also good. So what are the seven structural signs given by Bjork? Seven structural signs are inclination of condyle, wherein the condyle should be either straight or slightly anterior angled, not posteriorly angled. Curvature, mandibular canal should be neatly, there should be a good curvature of the mandibular canal, it shouldn't be straight. Symphysis, that is inclination of symphysis, the chin should be prominent. It shouldn't be a retrognathic chin. It should be a prominent chin, not a chin which is doesn't have a good size. Shape of lower border of mandible. Shape of lower border of mandible means the antigonial notch shouldn't be there much. If there is a big antigonial notch, it is not a good growing mandible. Antigonial notch, if it is not prominent, then that is a sign of a good growing mandible. Interincisal angle should be around 1 or 2 degrees, 102 degrees, around that range. In case if it is more than that, then it is not a sign of a good growing mandible. Interpremolar angle also, it shouldn't be acute. Lower anterior facial height should be average or reduced. These are all seven structural signs of a good growing mandible. This can just be asked as any combination can be asked as a this thing as an MCQ. So there are numerous growth studies, which I would like to put it across over here. The main important growth studies over here are Boulton Brush Growth Study, Burlington Growth Study, and Michigan Growth Study. In Boulton Brush Growth Study, this was given by Broadbent. Burlington's Growth Study was given by Moyers. Michigan Growth Study was given by Riolo. This can be asked because all the growth predictions are based on some or the other growth study. So just make a note of it, just make a note of the names, and these are most commonly asked this time. So there are other ways of predicting growth as well. That is by Johnston's grid. Okay, in Johnston's grid, what is done is, grid is nothing but a graph paper. So you say it will be something like this. So you superimpose the cephalogram on SN plane, and wherever the box is, you can actually see which region it will be in the future. We can predict based upon the boxes wherever it is sitting. To make this more simple, later on, it was given in the form of a template where a standard, say an average ceph will be there, And over an average CEPH, a good CEPH, patient's cephalometry will be superimposed, and then we'll just see whether it is normal or abnormal, whatever has to be there, that will be seen. There is one more way of assessing growth. Ricketts gave something known as arc of growth, Ricketts arc of growth, where growth of mandible can be predicted. So he thought that mandible grows in the form of a circle, where these are also been what is PM point, EVA point have been asked earlier. Just make a note of it, why it is needed, where it is radius of a circle. So mandible grows in the form of a circle. So how is that? The circle is formed by mental protuberance and EVA point. So the points are given over here. You can just see in case along the radius of PM, that is mental protuberance and EVA, the mandible grows further. Other way of assessing predicting is also with the form of a short range VTO. VTO is a visual treatment objective. Okay, this can be used. This was given by Ricketts. You can see on Nason-Bason plane. Nason-Bason is one of the planes where it has to be superimposed. Okay, on the Nason-Bason plane, it is superimposed. Every analysis is superimposed in different region. This particular analysis, it's on Nason-Bason plane. Okay, this can be asked. Okay, now come, we have just finished the prediction aspect of it, because most of the time prediction basics of we always, whenever we think about prediction, we always concentrate on growth spurt. We miss out on the size, how it can be assessed, shape, how it can be assessed. So I've just briefed on this particular aspect of it. So now let us see about variability. We know that no two individuals are same. Each individual is different, right? So what is normal then? What is normal is what is generally seen, and what is typically seen, that is normal. So how do we assess what is normal? When a patient walks into our clinic, how do we know whether he is normal or abnormal? We just generally, the commonest way of assessing is through age versus weight or age versus height chart. How are we supposed to assess? If you see in the graph, in the center, there is a line which has been marked, that is the patient's chart, which is marked. So over here, you can see that two things have to be checked. One is whether the same region, whether they're in the same percentile throughout, they are growing in the same percentile, or whether there is any variation. If there is any variation, there might be a disease. And the second thing is they shouldn't go to the extremes. That is extreme 3 percentile, they shouldn't go. They should be between 4 to 96%. 1 to 3, they shouldn't be there. And between 98 and 100, they shouldn't be there. This is actually a percentile graph based upon for a particular age and weight. I think this will be seen in all pediatric clinics, and whenever the patient comes, it will be made, a chart has to be made. Why this has to be done? This is one more way of predicting growth, because all of a sudden, in case if there is any increase in height, it just means that the patient is entering a pubertal spurt. Coming to timing of growth, timing is asked multiple times. So let us see. Each biological clock is set differently. So let us see the timing aspect of growth. See, period of sudden acceleration of growth, as we are all aware, is a growth spurt. So infantile growth spurt, it occurs around 3 years, and juvenile by around 7 to 8 years, and in females, and 8 to 10 years in male. And pubertal spurt is 11 to 13 in females and 13 to 15 in males. So let us see a bit more in detail about adolescent growth spurt. What are you seeing? Adolescent growth spurt in girls is for around 3 to 3.5 years, and in males it is around 5 years. Why this has to be given importance is any kind of a growth modulation in girls, it should be, we get a shorter time frame as when compared to boys, where we get a longer time frame to manage it. Adolescent growth spurt in girls can be divided into 3 stages. In first stage, that is beginning, so there'll be appearing of breast buds or early pubic hair will be there. That will be for 1 year. The peak of growth is for 1 year. That is the middle stage, that is stage two, where there is a noticeable development of axillary hair and appearance of darker pubic hair. Stage three, if the patient gives a history telling that, or patient's parents rather, give a history telling that there is menarche, then there is end of growth. So whenever any patient comes, we have to just check with them for growth modulation. Whenever we are predicting growth chair side, we have to ask them, ask the parents rather, whether there is any pubic hair development or any axillary hair development. Axillary presence of an axillary hair is a sign that patient has already entered the peak of growth, and growth modulation has to be planned immediately. Coming to pubertal spurts in boys, that can be divided into four stages. I think you would have heard about a fat spurt. Fat spurt or an endomorph where the kid is more plump. So in case if it is more plump, it means that he has entered a fat spurt. All of a sudden, if he tends to put on weight, that is a fat spurt. That is predominantly because of estrogen secretion by Leydig cysts. Yes. Before this testosterone is secreted, initially estrogen will be secreted by Leydig cysts.
So fat spurt generally that will also be associated with as a endomorph we see just till the onset of pubertal growth spurt that will be there for a year. Then afterwards in stage two there'll be a slight increase in growth. It is actually you can tell it as onset of puberty. So there'll be a sudden increase in height, pubic hair appearance. It appears. And in the peak of growth that is actually stage three that will be for 1.5 years. So that is actually marked by slight hair on the upper lip. So and there'll be an increase in peak height velocity. And in stage four, there'll be a slight reduction. If at all you are checking the annual increment, that will be there for around 1.5 to 2 years. There'll be a slight reduction, and of course, there'll be adult features by around that time. So. Graph again. Let me just take a question where there is okay. Somebody wanted this graph to be explained. I'll just go back to the graph for checking growth. Yeah, coming back to the graph over here. Yeah, so in case whenever we are entering any pediatric clinic, we'll be seeing this age versus weight or age versus height graph. This can also be put in the clinic for assessment. Over here, whenever we are assessing, the kid should fall always between 4 to 96 percentile. See, whatever graph you are seeing, multiple lines, these are all different percentiles which are seen. All the lines are different percentiles. And in between, you can see that there is one more line which is irregular with a cross across. There is a line, and you can see over here. Yeah, you can see in between there is one more hand-drawn line. It is tough for me to, I don't have a pointer to show. There's a hand-drawn line over here. So when that is the thing, there is a hand-drawn line. Yeah, this is the hand-drawn line. Yeah. So the kid has to be assessed periodically. What are we supposed to see is whether the same curvature is followed or there is a sudden variation. In case if there's sudden variation, then it may be a growth spurt which is occurring. In case if it goes beyond this, then it has to be assessed clinically or some kind of a whether there is some growth disturbance which is occurring or excess of hormonal secretion is occurring where it may lead to gigantism or something. That has to be assessed. Normal growth is in between 4 to 96% percentile rather 4 to 96 percentile 0 to 3 and 97 to 100 are the extremities. Kid should always be there in this particular percentile and the same curve should be followed throughout. There shouldn't be any upward or a groundward lower variation. Coming back to the growth spurts, you can see over here in boys that it is there for 5 years, as against girls, which is for around 3 to 3.5 years. For boys, they have got good 5 years for doing any kind of a growth modulation. And it's very easy to assess in guys because they have got a longer time and longer, lot of features are there as when compared with girls. Coming to hand-wrist radiographs, the previous one was secondary sexual assessment of secondary sexual characters for assessing growth prediction. Now we can also check hand-wrist for assessing growth. So as we know, in the hand-wrist we have got phalanges, metacarpals, and carpals. Generally, right hand is used. So we know that this is abductor sesamoid. This is abductor sesamoid is there around over here. Appearance of that, it means that peak of growth is getting attained. And I also want to tell you regarding the ossification of phalanges. You can see that in over here, there is width of epiphysis and diaphysis is same. Metaphysis is not seen it is not seen on a radiograph. Epiphysis and metaphysis, it is of same width. Here you can see a mild curvature is there. Mild appearance of a mild curvature over here means that it has started to cap. And once it has capped, epiphysis will fuse to diaphysis. This is diaphysis, this is epiphysis. Okay, now coming to Fishman's skeletal maturity indicators, you can see over here he has got 11 stages and four regions he'll be checking. So initially it will be, you can see over here that epiphyseal width is equal to diaphysis over here. Then you can see in one more stage abductor sesamoid is getting formed. And then you can see that there is capping. There is capping. And over here, you can see that there is fusion of epiphysis to diaphysis. These are the four stages. You can see over here that the initial stage over here in the first stage, PP3, MP3, and MP5. This is PP3's proximal phalanx of third finger, middle phalanx of third finger, and MP5 is middle phalanx of fifth finger. That is the little finger that forms the initial section. Then ossification over here in the next region you have got over here, abductor sesamoid is getting calcified, which just means that it is acceleration of pubertal growth spurt. That is acceleration phase. That is just an onset of pubertal growth spurt. And then over here, you have got DP3, that is distal phalanx of three in fifth stage. Six is middle phalanx of three capping, and seventh is middle phalanx of fifth in little finger, there is capping. And in fusion stage, you got last where there's deceleration of growth is there. There is distal phalanx of three, proximal phalanx of three, middle phalanx of three, and radius fusion. It just means that there is completion. So you've got accelerating growth from SMI 1 to 3 and peak velocity between 4 to 7 and deceleration between 8 to 11. There are other skeletal maturity indices as well. You can just remember the stages where the peak is attained so that before and after you can just guess whether it will be an onset or it will be a deceleration phase. I'll just show you this. You can see in case in Fishman's index in SMI stage 6, you can see that there is peak velocity of growth. In Hagen-Taranger, that is one more method of assessing, it is MP3, that is the middle phalanx 3. He divides that into FFG and G. So over there, in case if it is G stage, means it is at or 1 year after peak height velocity. Bjorkgrave-Brown, this is hand-wrist radiograph again. So over there, stage 5 means there is an MP3 cap, that is middle phalanx 3 capping is occurring. PP1 is proximal phalanx 1 cap, and R1 cap is radius capping. So that occurring means peak growth velocity is there. And of course, stage 4 is in Singer's method. Stage 4 is calcified ulna sesamoid, whatever is around the thumb over here. This is the ulna sesamoid over here, and an MP3 cap, that is middle phalanx 3 cap, meaning there is a peak, whatever is there. So this is just a summary for all stages. Apart from this, in case if the numbers are less, then you can just guess the answer as it is towards an onset. And if it is more than that, you can guess it towards as a deceleration. The peak is towards these particular stages, whichever has been mentioned. One more way of assessing skeletal maturity is through cervical vertebrae maturation. This is by Hazel and Furman. Why we went from hand to cervical vertebrae is because separate radiograph is not needed, so there'll be reduced radiation. Second thing is, studies have shown that cervical vertebrae maturation is more accurate than a hand wrist, and it correlates better for growth. So growth prediction, if you've got something, which will be better, whether hand wrist or cervical vertebrae is better than hand wrist. It was initially given by Hazel and Farman. What Hazel and Farman did was he considered till C6 vertebra, but because in case if they are putting a thyroid coil for radiation, 5 and 6 may not be seen. So Franchi, Basseter, McNamara, whatever you are actually seeing right now in the textbook, or even Balaji, or whatever you see, is actually a modification by Franchi, Basseter, McNamara. And let us just see that. You can see over here that there are 6 stages. One is CS1 is initiation stage, where it is more trapezoidal. It is more trapezoidal. It is more trapezoidal. As and when there's an acceleration from trapezoidal, it goes more towards a rectangular kind of a mode. From rectangular, it goes more towards square. This is change in shape, and also there'll be change in the lower border. Both have to be considered. How does it change in the lower border? In the lower border, first it will be flat, and then there'll be a slight curvature will start occurring, and then later on there'll be an accentuated curvature in the lower border. So both the alteration in shape as well as alteration of the lower border has to be considered whenever the to assess the staging. So you can see over here that between CS3 and CS4 is the peak. We cannot predict the peak using cervical vertebrae maturation, or rather very specifically even during other hand wrist as well, to exactly know what is a peak. So we know that peak is somewhere between CS3 and CS4, cervical vertebrae stage 3 and stage 4. Okay, so CS1 is of course the initial stage. Again, you have got all the other one after another, all the stages, whatever is occurring. You can see over here that between CS3 is 1 year before, and CS4 is 1 year after. So you've got any kind of a growth modulation you're doing, it is better to start during CS3. How do we know what stage is what? I'll just slightly describe so that you can just remember this. If you see in CS1, C2, C3, C4, all the three, the lower borders are flat. Okay. In CS2, remember 2, second vertebra, there is lower border concavity is appearing. In 3, both second and third vertebra, lower border concavity is appearing. In CS4, second, third, fourth, all the four lower border concavity is appearing. And you can also see from CS3 to 4, triangle has become slightly more rectangular. And in CS4 onwards, concavity is always there, but there'll be from rectangle, it is becoming more and more longer in height. So that is, it is becoming more and more from rectangular, it is becoming more and more square. So as and when the boy grows or anybody grows, the height of the vertebra will also increase. So you can just remember in this particular way. I repeat again, CS1, everything is flat. CS2, second vertebra, there is concavity. 3, second and third, there is concavity. 4, second, third, and fourth, there is concavity. In 5, from rectangle, it is becoming more and more square, and lower border concavity is increasing. In 6, there is completely, it will be like an adult in shape, and there is completion of growth. So, what are the methods of studying growth? Prophet gave two approaches, that is measurement approach and experimental approach. Measurement, we can take something and measure, say a triangle, I mean, sorry,
a set square, a scale, or something. There is some way you can actually measure it. That is measurement approach. That is by craniometry. That is in case of historical data. Say you find a skull and from that you are measuring. That is craniometry. Say the old ancestors, apes, all those things are all comes under craniometry. Anthropometry, it is all under living organisms. Anthropometry comes up. So across a population, if at all you are checking the size of an individual, whatever we assess clinically, it all comes under anthropometry. Comparative anatomy is nothing but comparing one to one more species, say human to apes comparison in size, say how is the face height of humans compared to face size of apes, that is comparative anatomy. Cephalometry, we are all aware. 3D imaging also, we are all aware, where an MRI and other CBCT can be taken into consideration. This is measurement approach. This has also been asked earlier. And what about experimental approach? Experimental approach was given by vital staining, was given by Hunter. And several radioisotopes can be used, that is technetium, calcium, potassium. This can be injected. So wherever there is a lot of growth occurring, this radioisotope will get deposited and we can see growth. So experimental approaches, generally it is done in the lab, where more so on rats or any other kind of a thing. Of course, one more way of experimental approach was given by Bjork, which was on implant radiology, which we will see. Yeah, this is the same thing, whatever I had already mentioned, that is experimental approach by Hunter, whatever was given. He gave, actually, he saw that pigs were fed with it was something like cabbage. I don't exactly remember the name. And in the bone, when it was dissected, it was all reddish. So you could see the annual increment of growth. And that was by alizarin. Alizarin red can be used. And radioisotopes I've already described. Implant, coming to implant radiology. This is by Bjork. And as we can see, he placed some tantalum implants. You can see over here in the symphysis, you can see a white dot. And you can see all the other regions there were. Yeah, this you can see over here. There's a dot, dot, dot over here, dot. These are all actually implants which are placed. And serial radiographs were taken year after year just to see how these points have moved and growth was assessed. This is one more way of assessing. So coming to end of this entire presentation, I just want to do a couple of discussion, and if you're able to tell the answers, I think that'll be really nice. Okay, one more thing what I would like to add is the entire presentation I have actually picked up from the previous papers. So many of the topics, whatever is seen in a textbook may not be there, or something else I've actually added because it was prepared from previous papers. So if you feel something is missed, or if you feel something else, you have got some doubts on the same topic, I think you can be open. You can just ask me through WhatsApp. If you've got some other thing, you can ask me. I'll be covering mandibular growth, maxillary growth, and other growth related topics at a later point of time in the next presentation. Predominantly, I've concentrated on pattern variability and timing, a bit of elaboration on prediction as such, because I felt it may be asked over there. That was one region which wasn't covered much earlier. And of course, timing of growth. So growth theories of growth, growth site center, as well as other growth of maxilla, mandible, and dentition, I think I'll be covering in the next presentation as and when I'll be doing it. So if at all you're having some questions pertaining to today's topic or anything which you feel I have missed out or you want me to cover or you've got some doubts, you can just ask me. Feel free to ask, and let us go by the first one. This is the great, okay, let us, I think this is pretty simple. Greatest amount of cranial growth occurs by which year? So if somebody can actually tell me the answer, I think that'll be great. So I think, yeah, please, where in the radio? Okay, Kaustav wants to know, okay, we'll just finish this and we'll go back to Kaustav. Yeah, Sakshi is telling that it's around 5 years, perfect. So one of the clinical implication of this is that all are cephalometric. In case if you are seeing, all cephalometric superimpositions are done on the cranial base predominantly, or structures very close to the cranial base, such as an FH plane is used, or anterior cranial base, or the entire cranial base is used for superimpositions only for one reason, that the growth occurs first. So that is the clinical implication, or any kind of a, if at all anything is being asked. And if a person purchases the hat at the age of around 6 to 7 years, I think that same hat will be sufficient for his entire age. So if there is any sudden change in the size of head, then that is predominantly seen in some kind of a disease. So one of the examples can also be Paget's disease, where in case somebody puts on a hat, we were discussing about cranial growth, and as I was mentioning that hat of a person, it doesn't alter much in entire during the entire lifetime, because of beyond 6 years, the shape of head doesn't alter much. So if there is any alteration, then other growth-related disturbances such as Paget's disease or anything has to be checked. So maximum height velocity in children is seen in which year? That is first, third, fifth, or seventh. So what's the answer? Meanwhile, I'll be explaining Kausal's. He wanted to know where implants were placed in a radiograph. I'll be telling till somebody can type an answer over here. I'll be explaining Kausal simultaneously. Actually, it can be placed in the regions which doesn't alter during the time of growth, meaning there shouldn't be any remodeling. In those places, generally, the tantalum implants were placed. So that was around the mandibular canal in mandible, and in the symphysis, where there is not much of growth in the mandible, it was placed. In the maxilla, it was placed very close to the anterior nasal spine. These were the regions where tantalum implants were placed. Coming to maximum height velocity, seen in children, as we are all aware, it is that answer will be B, where it's 3 years. That's when the maximum peak velocity is seen in children. That is the initial spurt, whatever is seen. And treatment of retrographic mandible is better started according to CBMS stages, that is Hazel and Farman staging. I'm just asking over here. So it is better started in stage 1, 2, or 3, or 4. It is A, B, C, or D. Any guesses? It is generally seen in stage 3. It is better started at the stage 3, where it is 1 year before the peak. As we are already aware of it, between 3 and 4 the peak arises. So where exactly the peak, which is the peak of growth, it is tough to predict. So it is better to start a year prior to peak. So that is at around CVMI stage 3. CVMI stage 3 is wherein 2, 3, and 4, all the three will have concavity at the lower border. So that's about pattern. Okay, I've got one more question over here. So maxillary growth in sagittal direction. So maxillary growth over here in CVMS full form. CVMS full form is cervical vertebrae maturation scale. Instead of index, you've got a scale. That's the difference over here. Okay, maxillary growth in sagittal direction. So maxillary growth in sagittal direction, if you're looking at it, it continues. Choice A is continuous with mandible. B is ceases 1 or 2 years before mandible, continues 1 or 2 years after mandibular growth, and varies from patient to patient. So what is the answer over here? Any guesses? I think it maxillary growth, it ceases 1 or 2 years before the mandibular growth. So it is always whenever you are planning for any kind of a headgear where the maxilla is already growing excess. So it is better to start the treatment, not to wait for pubertal spurt or onset of puberty. It is better to start slightly earlier at a pre-pubertal stage. So this is regarding maxillary growth whenever it is excess, but whenever it is deficient, it is better to start early and continue beyond mandibular, beyond puberty. That is the other thing, in order to control, so that whatever growth is there, it can be utilized. So whenever it is deficient, start early in case of mandible, and whenever it in case of sorry in case of maxilla, whenever it is excess also, start just before puberty in case of maxilla. This is regarding maxillary growth in sagittal direction. So any other doubts, you can just message on this, and that's about it. And that's for today. See you after a couple of weeks. I'll be coming with growth of maxilla, mandible, as well as different growth theories of growth. That's about it. Thank you. Good evening. See you then.